You're listening to Christian Audio's production of Act Like Men, 40 Days to Biblical Manhood by James MacDonald. This book is read by Joe Jeffrey. This audio recording was produced in 2016 by Christian Audio, which owns the copyright. No portion of this recording may be reproduced for any reason without prior written consent from Christian Audio. This edition, issued by contractual arrangement with Moody Publishers, originally published in English as Act Like Men, 40 Days to Biblical Manhood, copyright 2014 by James MacDonald. All rights reserved. Please visit christianaudio.com, facebook.com/christianaudio, or twitter.com/christianaudio to offer your impressions of this work and to explore additional titles. Foreword. Early on in my church planting experiences, I met with a group of men for Bible study. Together, we looked carefully at the qualities of maturity outlined by the Apostle Paul in his letters to Timothy and Titus, a 20-week experience that was life-changing for all of us. Our goal was to measure up more and more to the fullness of Christ. As a result, a publishing friend of mine encouraged me to write The Measure of a Man. Little did I realize how God was going to use it, even to this day. Not because I wrote it, but because the qualities of maturity came from the pen of Paul as he wrote by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. The basic characteristics of maturity in this book, Act Like Men, authored by James MacDonald, also come from the pen of the Apostle Paul when he wrote to the Corinthians. It is a succinct and powerful profile for becoming mature in Christ. Be watchful. Stand firm in the faith. Act like men. Be strong. Let all that you do be done in love. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 13 and 14. In many respects, I've watched this book emerge. Though James MacDonald and I had known each other casually, we developed a growing friendship several years ago when he was going through some very deep waters. Though incredibly successful as a senior pastor at Harvest Bible Chapel, with an exploding network of affiliated churches and a worldwide broadcast ministry, he was facing serious criticisms in his own church. Through a series of events, James invited me into his life as a mentor and encourager. Having been down the road many miles as a church planting pastor, I too have been through some tough terrain. Like him, I had made some decisions and statements that resulted in some very painful experiences. I was simply able to share from my own ministry life. As I reflect on our face-to-face communications, dozens of telephone calls, emails, and texts, I discovered a man who wanted to learn, rebuild bridges that were broken down, and overall make changes in his life and approach to leadership. I discovered a man who sincerely desires to reflect the humility of Jesus Christ in every aspect of his life. Consequently, this book, Act Like Men, reflects not only the author's unique ability to communicate God's truth, but the way in which God's truth is impacting his own ministry and family. Let me address this book from two perspectives, personally and pragmatically. First, what makes MacDonald's words very powerful and convicting, beyond speaking God's truth, is his vulnerability in personal matters. His struggles are on display, as well as his steps to victory, making his straightforward exhortations authentic and convicting. Second, this book reflects a pragmatic design that will appeal to men. The chapters are short and pithy. His opening stories and illustrations will grab your attention. His expositions and applications are an easy read. His questions at the end of each chapter will lead you to deeper engagement and are great for group discussion. And his prayers at the end of every chapter reflect the author's own sincere desire and quest to be the man God created him to be. I identify with the spirit and the content of these prayers, and I'm confident you will too. They focus on needs in every man's heart and life. Alone, if taken seriously, these prayers could change your life. Dr. Jean A. Getz, Professor, Pastor, Author, President, Center for Church Renewal, Plano, Texas. Introduction. Hey, don't skip the introduction. Most men like to know what they're getting themselves into and what it will take to make the finish line. This overview tells you where we're going in this book, how we'll get there, and how your investment in listening to it can make a real and lasting difference in your life. It's a little longer than usual, but I promise the individual chapters' studies will be much shorter than you expect. What do you want first, the good news or the bad news? It's the kind of bumpy start you expect when a tough subject has to be discussed. Typically, the nervous person with the hard message to deliver, finding no easy point of access, begins with a common question. So what do you want first? Then they launch with the bad news regardless of your answer. So here it goes. Bad news. Men are in trouble. Men are in deep trouble with sin. Every statistic says that most men are somewhere between dabbling on the edges of a self-disqualifying and self-destructive sin or actually wading right into it. In fact, the five main areas where men spend their money, electronics, sports, cars, gambling, and alcohol, are all clues to a self-centered perspective. Men are struggling, stumbling, and proving notoriously weak in the face of temptation. The rampant spread of internet porn is devouring men's souls like a new and deadly form of cancer. Its lure of private pleasure turns out to be a thin veil over the havoc it causes in marriages and public lives. The decay of sin is everywhere. This isn't going anywhere good. Something has to change. These issues have immediate and long-term impact on those we love most. We're losing our kids. Even when marriages remain unbroken, how many children are growing up without what God designed men as fathers to give? Paternity is a long way from fatherhood. Two-income families may relieve financial pressure, but it doesn't prepare kids for the moral minefield that is waiting to detonate their hopes and dreams. Men are also in trouble because of their own shallow spirituality. In a 2013 Forbes article entitled, 14 Things Successful People Do on Weekends, there isn't even a mention of God. Western world watered-down church was reshaped to reach men, but it bores them like a Saturday afternoon trip to Target. Men want to do something hard. Men want to be challenged, to stretch and test the limits of who they are. God designed them that way, and church is placating men instead of calling them to something much higher. I won't make that mistake here. More bad news. Men don't work on themselves. Most women put forth continual efforts to learn and improve themselves. The biggest category of books is self-help, and women are the ones forking over the cash to see how they can grow. Guys work on projects. Women work on themselves. Guys roof the garage, paint the basement, and fix the kids' bikes. Women think about relationships and focus on their families. Yes, of course, I know there are exceptions to these broad generalizations. We all know the guy who gets a pedicure and frosts his tips. But most men think that guy is wacky and only talk to him when forced. We also know the woman who swears like a sailor and changes the oil in her own car. But if she's your wife, that says more about you than it does about her. Both cases are simply the exceptions that prove the rule. This is not a book for the 500 men in the world who read GQ magazine, or the 250 men debating theology as an end to itself. This is a book for Joe Screwdriver, the regular guy, like you and me. More on Joe in a moment. Soul work. Soul is not a kind of food or a style of music. It is the seat of man's desire, the place where wanting resides. The soul is the non-physical part of every human being that sets us apart from the animals. Your soul is made up of mind, emotion, and will. It's the place where you think and feel and choose. When your soul is satisfied, you have everything, even if you have nothing. And when your soul is not at peace, you have nothing, no matter what you have attained or acquired. Soul work is hard work. Failure to extend the effort has us stuffing our demanding souls with all kinds of selfish, super attractive, but unsatisfying scraps the Bible calls sin. It cuts a swath of destruction across a man's life like a tornado across a Nebraska cornfield. So, instead of consuming more sex and pursuing more power and other selfish stuff like we devour popcorn shrimp at a Super Bowl party, we're going to do something stretching here, and it will be worth it. Yes, this is your time to turn from those things that have only made you restless and miserable and get busy on the role God created you to fulfill, which will bring you a joy you never thought possible. First, though, one more piece of bad news. Even more bad news. Men don't read. If you know anything about men, you know we generally don't read many books or spend a ton of time talking to the few men who do read and read and read. Most men consider it a chore to consult the instruction manual about how to assemble something and would rather build it twice than study something longer than playoff scores. Men are famous for refusing even the 2-second step of reading road signs, let alone reading a map, which is more pictures than words and not real reading at all. Book retailers will tell you that most books are read by women, even books for men, and very few books of any kind are written specifically for guys. What would be the point? So here goes crazy me, throwing down where angels fear to tread. I'm recording this book with the wild goal that men who can't remember the last book they opened and don't plan to read in the future will take time to listen to this. I want to help real men who are facing real issues and in need of a big-time turnaround. This is not a bit of helpful advice, but a total renovation of what you're doing with your life and why. If you're tired of living for sex and sandwiches, or something just as silly, you're on the right track. Now for the good news. Good news. Keep it simple, stupid. Kiss is more than a 70s rock band with hair in their ears and Viagra in their pockets. Kiss has become an acronym for the stupidity of not keeping things as simple as possible. This is especially important for men. The stupid guy isn't the dude who rejects complicated treatises on biblical masculinity and reading theological speculations about the third heaven. The stupid person is the guy who can't put complex truth in a way that everyday men can appreciate it. I hope to avoid that stupidity here. It has always been instructive to me that the Holy Spirit inspired the Apostle Peter to use 6 verses, 151 English words, to describe in detail and illustrate the role of women in marriage. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Why then only a single verse, 38 English words, to describe a man's responsibility to his wife? 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7. Answer? Because men like it boiled down, bottom line, give it to me quick, and let me get after it. Men also like it direct, not talking about some other guy, but talking to you, the guy listening to the book. For that reason, I'm going to change the voice of this book right now. Voice is the position the author takes as he writes. I'm not going to write anymore as a third party saying things about men. This is a book about me and you. Hear the difference? The content may be upsetting to your sensibilities, but you will never have to wonder about my subject or my audience. You talking to me? Picture De Niro with rough New York accent. Yes, I am. My goal is to talk to you through this audiobook in a clear, direct, and to-the-point way. You may find some parts tough to take and challenging to apply, but I promise you won't ever wonder what I'm talking about. If you get ticked, stop listening and come back to it later. Further, because you shouldn't have to take my word for anything, I'm going to base all I write on the Bible. God's word has been redirecting men's hearts for thousands of years, and we do well to show it some respect and carefully consider its message. More good news. You can have a fresh start. I am writing from the perspective of a Christian. The good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ is that God loves sinful men. He did not come to condemn them or to judge them. He came to save them, to rebuild them, to transform them for His purposes. God takes lives that are stuck on sin and selfishness and reboots them. If you picked up this recording because you need God to redeem your regrets and restore what sin has stolen from you, this is going to be awesome. When I was 17, God took hold of my life with the message of love and forgiveness that is found in Jesus Christ, and He has never let go. If you know and love the Lord, or if you are just new to all this, the message remains the same. God loves you, Jesus died to secure your forgiveness, And if you are ready to turn from all patterns of sin and believe in the resurrected Savior Jesus Christ for your forgiveness, you can begin again with the assurance that God accepts you and is committed to building you into a new man. Still more good news. This book is for regular guys. Allow me to introduce a friend of mine, Joe Screwdriver. Works a job he is not always crazy about and never seems to finish his wife's lists of house stuff that needs to get fixed, cleaned, or put away. He used to think about doing something grand and becoming someone great, but now he's just glad to be getting by. Joe is married with kids and wants it to last for a ton of good reasons. Memo to single guys. By the way, if you're single or single again, you should listen to this. But understand that it's about where you're trying to get to or get back to. I'm not going to keep writing separate stuff for you, like you are okay to stay where you are, unless you have a direct word from God Almighty Himself asking you to stay single. I kind of want you single guys to get busy and pick one of the 2 trillion amazing available Christian women who are waiting for you to get tired of Call of Duty and porn, or however you've been spinning your wheels. I want you to find a good woman and get serious about building a legacy of Christ-honoring kids and grandkids. Okay? Now, back to Mr. Screwdriver, who loves his family dearly but finds it tough at times to tell them how he feels. He goes to church but doesn't always get much from it, and sometimes won't think about God again until next week. Joe prays, but mostly a sentence or two in times of desperation. Joe wants to know God better, but wonders why it always seems like work. Joe has enough money to pay the bills and tries not to buy dumb stuff he can't afford, a mistake he never wants to make again. Joe is about getting the job done and would never call himself unhappy. But truthfully, he doesn't have a ton of time to think about such things. Joe is not concerned with fashion, isn't overly punctual or neat, and he's not a fan of fake anything. He can't figure out what the guy with the hair plugs is going for. Joe knows he's just the average guy, the face in the crowd, the forgotten majority. His voice is not heard, his thoughts are not sought out, and his opinions seem totally unheard in the noise of the world's loudmouths who would rather be infamous than anonymous. If you don't understand men, you might see Joe as complicated. But if you study him, he's actually pretty predictable. Joe knows what he knows and is a stand-up, straight-ahead guy. I wrote my doctoral thesis to help Joe be more open about the things he struggles with, and I started a church in a warehouse because Joe doesn't need fluff or fancy. I think about Joe when I have a sermon to prepare, but this is the first time I've ever written a whole book with Joe in mind, and I'm excited about the challenge. I love this guy. Joe Screwdriver is the sum total of all the men I have ever known. He is, in fact, every man, because he doesn't represent the few things that make us different. Joe Screwdriver epitomizes the many, many things that make you and me so similar as men. Does this sound familiar? Joe Screwdriver gets angry about injustice, especially toward women and children. He likes sports, but doesn't live for them. He loves a close game, especially if the underdog pulls it out in overtime, because Joe feels like regular folk could use a leg up in this world. Right now, Joe is wondering if I will ever stop babbling and cut to the chase with some actual help. Yes, I will, Joe. Right now. How to get the most from Act Like Men. 2 main Bible verses outline this book. I will use a lot of Bible verses sprinkled throughout the chapters, but don't be overwhelmed. The book is really about 2 main Bible verses I want you to learn. At the end of Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, he exhorts believers to take hold of what they long for and what God created them to be and experience. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7, Paul challenges all Christians to demonstrate the tenderness best illustrated in a nursing mother with her children. While that sensitive care is natural to a mother, it is commanded of all of us. In that same way, Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 13 and 14, exhorts all believers to reflect the strengths that are relative to masculinity. While these characteristics are also to be seen in each of us, they should come most naturally and are needed most urgently in men. The purpose of this book is to call men to lead the way in exhibiting these characteristics that reflect God's creative intent for masculinity. Be watchful Stand firm in the faith. Act like men. Be strong. Let all that you do be done in love. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 13 and 14. Five imperatives, simple direct commands that, when rightly understood, don't leave room to wiggle. In these five imperatives, I see a wonderful summary of what God intends for you and me. The middle exhortation, act like men, is the defining center around which the other four exhortations gather. So we'll handle it first. Act like men is the hub, if you will, of the wheel that biblical masculinity rolls around. Put the five together, and they form a fantastic game plan for men seeking clear direction on how to order their priorities in a God-honoring, soul-satisfying way. And because it is directed to men, God's instruction comes to us the way men want it, condensed and straight to the point. Assertion number one, act like men, the quality imperative the other four rally around. Assertion number two, be watchful, an imperative about urgency and getting after what matters most of all. Assertion number three, stand firm. The urgency imperative derails if we don't have clarity. Assertion number four, be strong. The imperative of authenticity and freedom from pretense. Assertion number five, all done in love. The final imperative of lasting, satisfying community that fuels the other four. Okay, got it? Five sections, one about each biblical imperative and how total obedience to it can fulfill what God made us as men to experience. 40 studies in all. Long chapters tend to bore men and frustrate them when they can't sit long enough to plow through one. For that reason, each of the five sections out of our theme verse of 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 13 and 14, will be examined briefly from eight common angles. Each section will cover 1. The biblical imperative, what it means and what it looks like in our lives. 2. The single word that best defines what the imperative means and how to experience it. 3. An Old Testament example, a man who refused this imperative and suffered the consequences. 4. The way the Apostle Paul exemplified this imperative and how you can too. 5. The satanic lie men believe that keeps us from embracing this imperative. 6. How God the Father perfects that imperative. 7. How Jesus Christ personifies that imperative. 8. How the Holy Spirit empowers that imperative. Okay, got it? 8 studies about each of the five imperatives for a total of 40 studies. Why study biblical men? Some of the guys in the Bible are real characters, if you know what I mean. They went through a lot of messy stuff to get to the place where they knew they needed God more than anyone or anything. If you are not there yet, that's okay. These men are mentioned in God's Word for a reason. They are not glossy or retouched photos that mask a darker reality. Don't think that we can't relate to these biblical men because centuries separate us from them. The stark revelation of their struggles and what God taught them reveal that the way men have changed through the centuries is meaningless compared to the ways we have stayed the same. We're going to learn from a Bible man's mistakes in every chapter, as well as from the example of Paul, and finally from the God-man, Jesus Christ. Why the personal stories? One of the biggest hindrances to relationship among men is our tendency to hold things inside. We hide and cover and close ourselves off to the kind of openness that causes male friendships to flourish and faith in God to grow. You may be fearful of making yourself known. Possibly you are fearful, or have been hurt, or only ever learned to bottle up what you experience. Amazing things happen when men drop their guard and get honest with each other. And I'm going to take the difficult step of going first. In almost every study, I'm going to use personal illustrations, more by far than in any of the other books I've written. I'm going to be pretty open about lessons I've learned, mistakes I've made, situations I have gotten myself into, etc. It's not that I think my life is interesting, and I would rather keep it private in many ways. But my prayer is that through opening up about hard stuff I have had to learn, you will feel like you have permission to do the same, because that's when the change really begins to happen. It would be incredible if you listened to this book and discussed it with other men as you move through it. That will make all the difference. Questions for reflection. As you listen, I encourage you to write your thoughts in a journal. I will be encouraging you to get another man you respect to read or listen to this book at the same time. Possibly you can meet to discuss your answers. The important purpose of the questions is to open up your mind to what you have been listening to, ensure you understand it, and begin thinking about the changes needed to see that soul craving more fully satisfied in your life. The value of doing these studies alongside another guy is that it will increase the probability of getting through the process. Prayers to pray. Each chapter ends with a targeted prayer to pray. Don't skip these. They are not formulaic prayers, but requests and confessions I have made for you and for myself in writing this book and launching the Act Like Men conferences. If you humble yourself before God, even kneel down and pray out loud, alone, where no one can hear you, something very powerful will begin to happen. You will sense God's presence with you and His favor upon your strong and growing desire to experience the very purposes for which He has made you. In fact, let's stop to pray right now. Father in heaven, my longing to be the man you have created me to be is exceeded only by my acute awareness that I am not yet that man. Thank you for leading me to the place where I am now, holding a plan to get to a better place. Please forgive me for the times I have failed to act like a man and for the grief that has caused others to count on me. Birth in my heart this moment a focused hope that you have something better in store for me and those I love. Thank you for the grace that allows me to change. I pray for the strength to seize this opportunity with my whole heart. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Okay, keep listening and let's get into section number one. Section 1. Act Like Men. 1. Acting Like Men. Be watchful. Stand firm in the faith. Act like men. Be strong. Let all that you do be done in love. I was pretty excited when I walked into the diner and saw a table full of good old boys hungrily forking their breakfast. Truckers, retired farmers, and guys with military insignia on their baseball caps made up the group. These dudes were no nonsense, to be sure, and looked up pretty suspiciously as I approached their table. Our church has a 650-acre camp in Croton, Michigan, and I love to go there when I'm working on a writing project. Croton is located in Newaygo County, a mostly woods, lakes, and small towns area of Michigan. What is lost in bling and bright lights is more than made up for in real as it gets, straight shooting authenticity. The particular diner I love to hang out at has no name, but the sign says great food, and it isn't a lie. The place gets pretty packed, overflowing with regular folk who want fresh food for a fair price. Arriving at the crowded table, I sensed the men stiffen up and wondered if I had made a mistake. "Hey, you guys have a second to answer a question for me?" Everyone froze. "I'm working on a book," I continued. "I recognize a table full of good old boys when I see one, and I want to know what you think it means to act like a man." The first guy to break the silence objected gruffly to my use of the term old. I scratched my beard and said, "It takes one to know one." Everyone laughed, the tension broke, and they began to eagerly answer my question. "Acting like a man means doing what you say you're going to do," the first guy offered. "It means not doing anything under the table when you're making a deal," another added. "Keeping your word," a man called the mayor declared. "And not making any excuses," added the first man, jumping back in. "Yes," they all seemed to chime in at that. "Nothing worse than a man who makes excuses, blames others, and refuses responsibility for his own actions." No doubt there were real experiences that underlined the worthlessness of excuse makers for these men. You can learn a lot from regular folk who are too immersed in life's realities to posture for anyone. Every one of those guys is a Joe Screwdriver of sorts, and I renewed my determination to write a book that could connect with good men like them. The Bible asserts that the words it contains are God's words, and they are living and active. I know this is true because I've been studying the Bible for more than 3 decades, but I never open it without finding stuff I didn't see before, even in places I've studied in depth. That's why I shouldn't have been surprised when a recent journey through 1 Corinthians yielded an observation that had evaded me these many years. How could I have missed Paul's exhortation in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13, to act like men? I have witnessed the consequences for many men who have refused this exhortation by their practice, and to my shame, I have at times failed to meet this standard myself. In what seemed like my very first reading, the command hit me like a sledgehammer. I wrote the phrase down and began to pray that God would advance my understanding of what it really means to act like a man. Over a period of weeks and then months, I went back to this phrase again and again. Of course, Paul has all believers in mind with his 5 imperatives. However, it appears that these specific aspects of biblical maturity were best illustrated as expressions of masculinity. I like what Kistmaker states. Like a general in the army of the Lord, Paul gives short orders in rapid succession and expects his people to put his commands into practice. Clear, direct, succinct, just the way men like it. And while applicable to all for the purposes of our study, we will apply to men what Paul seems to indicate should come naturally to men. The power of these phrases is in their simplicity, and the more I have reflected on them, the more impactful they have become. Act like men means a lot of profound things that I hope to share as this book unfolds. But before it reveals anything super deep and insightful, it has to mean the following basics. Because it's just you and me communicating here, let's make Paul's plural into singular. Act like a man. Act like a man means don't act like a woman. Obvious, right? I've been happily married for more than 30 years. And I have no problem acknowledging that I'm a big fan of women in general, and my wife Kathy, specifically. I enjoy some days away with the boys, such as our Idaho bear hunt coming up in a few weeks. But I am always happy to get back to my wife, daughter, and 2 daughters-in-law. If you've read Genesis, the first book in the Bible, then you might remember that Adam, the first guy, was only around for about 10 minutes before God declared, "It is not good that the man should be alone." Who knows what trouble this guy was already into, but God was not going to let it continue and provided woman to be a helper fit for him. I think we would all agree that men and women fit together beautifully in every way, not just physically, but emotionally, relationally, and spiritually. One man with one woman for a lifetime is God's plan. Men and women are designed by their Creator to complement and complete, not compete with one another. Each is to become more because of the other than they could ever become alone. That has certainly been true in my life because of Kathy. I know we live in a world where distinction based on gender is frowned upon, but that doesn't alter reality one bit. Men and women are equal under God in every way, but they are not the same. It is possible to make some general observations based on gender. For example, you may have noticed that your woman has a different emotional makeup than you. She is scared by things you don't even notice, like driving with your knee while you hold a coffee and answer the phone, or walking down a dark alley late at night. She is touched by things that may seem silly to you, like a romantic scene in a movie, or a person in need who might make you more suspicious. Proverbs 18, verse 22 says, "He who finds a wife finds a good thing." And just like every man needs a good woman, women need men. Most of all, they need their man to be a source of strength, stability, and leadership. The major decisions and responsibilities of your home are on you, not your wife. They're your call. Listen to her, learn from her, but don't fail to lead her. Not many things are sadder than a passive man acting more like a woman while his wife is allowed to dominate and usurp the role God has called him to fulfill. It's on you to make sure that doesn't happen, so step up and lead. Lead with love, service, and tenderness, to be sure, but act like a man and lead. Men are made to provide security for their wives. Men are designed to cover women with their strength, offering the protection and security God made them to need. As men, we reap the benefits of our wives' emotional tenderness, and we have to make sure we are reciprocating with the strength they need. Sadly, though, how many families do you know where the husband is counting on the wife to lead, and in some cases, even to be, the main provider? There are a ton of acceptable divisions of labor that can work in a home, but none where you are not leading. It doesn't matter if she cuts the lawn and you cut the vegetables. It just matters that you lead. Failing to lead is failing to act like a man. I just checked with my wife, and she said it was okay for me to say this. Act like a man means don't act like an animal. Across the spectrum from the passive man who abdicates his God-given role as leader is the dominant, hyper-macho pseudo-man who doesn't love his wife selflessly as Christ commands. Instead, he expects to be served and barks selfishly whenever he feels he is not the obvious priority. Years ago, we were honored to welcome a famous special guest into our home. Every preparation was made to present ourselves in the warmest and most hospitable, respectful manner. I will never forget the horror on my wife's face when our dog dragged its hind parts across the carpet in front of our guest in an apparent attempt to itch himself where he couldn't reach. How is it possible that our dog missed the requisite delicacy hospitality demanded? Answer: he's an animal. Animals are wonderful, but when men act like animals, everyone around them is in big trouble. We are not to put our own needs ahead of our wife and children. We are to honor our parents and do our best to remain aloof from strife. We are to spend ourselves and deny ourselves and exhaust ourselves in servant leadership of our loved ones. Don't worry if it's been a while since you golfed or hunted or hung out with your buddies. Those things have a place and can fit in if and when possible. But refusing to make your own needs top priority is what makes you a man and not an animal. Much more on that later. Act like a man means don't act like a boy. I have 5 grandsons, all under the age of 5. Each one is a special joy, but I must say they have reminded me of what I forgot since my kids were small. In a moment, they can go from crying to laughing to fighting. They're loud, needy, and demanding. They're constantly on the search for new thrills, and their life revolves around the itch of the moment. Paul reports in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11, that when I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. Kids are not able to figure that the sun and moon don't revolve around them. Men are supposed to know this. Acting like a man means developing a non-anxious presence that sees the big picture, remains calm in a crisis, and won't cave in under pressure. Godly men respond, they don't react. I confess to having taken far too long to learn that truth. God had to put me in some very hot water before I was forced to realize the importance of being silent when slandered, merciful when in the right, and lovingly patient when wrong. Any kid can join a meaningless scrap in the schoolyard, but Paul completes the passage I just quoted by saying, when I became a man, I gave up childish ways. Act like a man means don't act like a superhero. For some, forsaking the superhero persona may be the most important distinction. The above exhortations call a man to strength and stability, but those do not mean men don't feel things deeply and at times struggle profoundly. We're not iron men. Every man needs a place to be open and vulnerable with brothers, leaning together upon the Lord. I hope you have a small group of men you meet with regularly, where you open your life up and seek the strength of numbers focused on a common goal. A circle of men who will hear your confessions and assure you of God's grace is a non-negotiable for biblical manhood. None of us is everything God calls us to be, and like James says, we all stumble in many ways. Acting like a man does not mean acting. The term actually means conduct yourself. It's the idea of intentionally choosing your behavior to reflect the best of what God calls us as men to be. We will talk about that on day 2, but for now take a moment to answer the questions below and pray for God's help. Questions for reflection. 1. What can you do today and this week to be a better servant leader to your family? 2. In what ways might recent actions have appeared selfish, and what can you do today to correct that? 3. Do you agree that a man keeping his word and refusing to make excuses is a good summary of manhood? Why? Prayer. Dear Father in heaven, thank you for creating man in your own image. Today I want to be more conformed to your image by more fully expressing your design for manhood. Please forgive me for the times I have acted selfishly or passively and failed to cover and care for my family, as you have commanded. Please help me today to feel the weight of my strength and use it wisely and carefully, so those that you have given to my care will sense my strong love for them. Stir faith and hope in me now. I pray that the careful reading of these 40 studies will take me into a deeper experience of your plan for my life than I have ever known before. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Next time, meet the quality man. 2. A quality man. Give instruction to a wise man, and he will be still wiser. Teach a righteous man, and he will increase in learning. The 1972 blockbuster and Oscar winner, The Godfather, is ranked by AFI as the number 2 movie of all time, and I admit to watching it at least once a year. I love the scene where Sonny argues with Tom that he needs a wartime consigliere. I cry when the Godfather gets shot and cheer when his youngest son, Michael, a war hero, saves his dad from assassins at the hospital. But best of all is the opening scene set on the day the Godfather's only daughter is to be married. Everyone is in the backyard celebrating, but Vito, the Godfather, is stuck in his office fulfilling an apparent Sicilian pledge not to refuse any man on the day he gives his daughter's hand in marriage. Various characters come and go requesting help or vengeance from the Godfather. Then a family friend named Johnny comes in, some kind of washed-up singer or actor, begging the Godfather to secure him a particular movie role he has been refused. He cries into his hands, "I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do." In that moment, the ever-calm Vito Corleone springs to his feet, pulls Johnny up by his hands, slaps him across the face, and shouts, "You can act like a man!" Later in that scene, he asks the singer, "Do you spend time with your family?" Adding, "Good, because a man who doesn't spend time with his family can never be a real man." The scene resonates so deeply because we see a strong man who loves his family and sacrifices for them, exhorting a shallow man to follow his example and stop being so weak. In reality, Vito's family is a mess and ends in ruin because of his sin, but his struggles to be a quality man for his family always grips and motivates me. I have never met the dude who didn't at some level want to be a quality man, but for some reason in the pressure of the moment, we often cave in to behavior we despise. Why are so many men living the life of Vito Corleone, wanting more than anything to build a loving, loyal, God-fearing family, but watching in horror as we make choices that establish us as obstacles to the very things we would swear matter most to us? Not just in the movies, but too often in real life, men tear down with their own hands the good that they set out to build. The phrase, "his own worst enemy," is widely recognized because it occurs with a frequency that staggers the mind. What is wrong with us? Why do we resonate with the biblical words, "For I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate"? The answer is found at a much deeper level of manhood than the behavioral. The problem is in our very nature, and only Christ can free us. As men, we are broken and don't work right. We have fallen and can't get up. Like the mag wheel on a low-profile sports car that is driven over a curb at high speed, men are bent, and the fix is possible but not easy. How we got bent. Adam, the first man, was declared by God to be good, Genesis chapter 1, verse 31, just after the Creator had breathed life into him. Fear of losing equality with God, falsely offered by the enemy, and anger that a God who spoke of love would deprive him of any perceived benefit propelled Adam and the whole human race into what theologians call depravity. Depravity is the essence of our fallen nature and where we remain, apart from an intervention by Christ. Depravity is an inability to choose the right and our constant inclination toward selfish sin. Like a cowlick that sticks up no matter how many times you stick it back, our nature as men is boldly bent toward badness. At the root of that bent are two powerful, sinful tendencies that must be conquered in Christ if we are to become quality men. Fearful men are not quality men. Get past the surface to the center of a man's soul, and you will see that much of what is driving his depravity is fear. Like a strong wind can turn a spark into a forest fire, fear inflames much of what men do that is destructive. Bill is afraid at failing at work, so he lies about his product to hit sales quotas. Kyle fears rejection, so he isolates himself with negativity and avoidance. Tom fears being cheated, so he attacks everyone with suspicion and cynicism. Jeff fears being alone, so he is constantly cultivating illicit relationships. Randy fears being like his father, but hears it in his voice as he yells at his kids. We could easily feel compassion for men like these, and many recognize ourselves in the generalized descriptions. But we must face the fact that a quality man overcomes his fear. Such a man refuses to be mastered by his anxiety and embraces the assurance that God gave us a spirit not of fear but of power and love and self-control. A quality man examines his heart, exposing the fears that generate the lies that lead to sin. What are you afraid of? Look directly at the action you most regret in the last year and answer this question. What were you afraid of? Confess fear as sin and confess the sin that fear produces. Ask God to replace that dread with a confident trust in His goodness. That's how a quality man acts. He faces and masters his fears instead of being mastered by them. Angry men are not quality men. I've struggled with anger in certain seasons of my entire adult life. I was emotional and impulsive as a student, but very seldom angry. As I've gone from years to decades in ministry, I marvel at the battle with anger that has lessened with time, but still calls for daily dependence on the Holy Spirit for self-control. I'm not a big fan of psychoanalysis, but I did seek out Dr. Garrett Higby, our church counselor, and spent a few days with Dr. Henry Cloud for insight into how I can experience longer seasons of victory over outbursts of anger. Do you know what I'm talking about? Have you heard yourself blow up at something seeming upon reflection to be small, but felt it wash over and consume you in a moment? Anger, at least in my life, is driven by hurt. Early on in the life of the church, my deficiencies as a leader were magnified and force-fed to me by a few co-founders. As a young man still in my 20s, I was devastated. A few years later, that pattern repeated itself with other leaders, and by the third cycle, about 15 years into the church's life, I had come to expect it. More and more, as I entered situations that seemed similar, I used anger to protect myself against hurt and betrayal. Instead of fearing a bad outcome in the face of needed confrontation, I ensured it through my anger and at least braced myself for the fallout. That is incredibly unhealthy and certainly not the characteristic of a quality man. To be successful in relationships, we must fully embrace the biblical observation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.